I think, just as a matter of introduction, I was asked only once in my life whether I was a librarian, and I'm not. So just in case you were asking yourselves. And that's an introduction to the background. It just happens that I've been in charge of defining the scientific information policies for a few major research organizations, what the EU Democrats call RPOs, Research Performing Organizations, CNRS in INRIA in France, and the Max Planck Society in Germany. I've also been coordinating a few standardization activities. I'm currently the chair of the TI, Text and Coding Initiative Council, so that you know I'm biased in this respect as well. And I've been pursuing the idea that we should accompany and anticipate basically what we've heard, the evolution of the publishing landscape, the switch to digital information, but not necessarily from the point of view of librarians, that's why I'm not a librarian, but from the point of view of researchers proper, what you call the customers. And these are the most, I mean, to my view, important person at the end of the day, because they are the one using the information. And the main point which I've been somehow defended in within the Max Planck Society recently, because I saw a lot of research directors in the Max Planck Society asking me whether they should just close down their libraries because they were empty, as what is the room for a research library in the new research environment there. The word of caution is basically that there's not one such thing as a research library. From a little institute library with its somehow archivist there to big national digital libraries like you would have with, we've got a representative of INIST here, or the Max Planck Digital Library, or the University of California Digital Library, which are big organization covering most of the topics you could think of related to scientific information. You cannot have one single message for all, but there are a few coherent themes that we could somehow grasp there. Like I said, the more libraries you visit, actually, the less you understand how they work. True, and basically what we've just heard about leads is a typical example. Some research libraries have actually taken the lead in deploying new technologies that maybe we need to speak about the World War One, the Lidl collections. And the other point is that a library exists because of the people, I mean the librarians who are there, and the actual ecology, the researchers who are using the data there. And depending on the background of the people, you may have orientations which are quite different, whether they are true information scientists, whether they are former scientists who have come to the library, or whether they are just computer scientists who just happen to be responsible of the library. I can give names. So the good old library, basically we've seen that. It's about acquisitions, cataloging, making things available, and basically you see the problem. There's a word in English I'm looking, I mean the kind of a, there's a clash basically between those missions and the actual positioning of the researchers. So they're not in the loop of the publishing, on the publishing side, so when a researcher writes a paper, the librarian does not know basically. Concerning cataloging, basically they are not considered as an interlocutor by the researchers or even the research institutions for retrieving information. We've seen that as well. And basically, empty libraries, this has been mentioned. I visited the library of the Max Planck Institute with Festkoffer Forschung. That's the, basically, these are chemists. And they were telling me that they had one visit of a student per week, in average. So it was a completely empty environment. Which is not true in the human sciences. On the other hand, if you look at the Max Planck Institute for the History of Art in Florence, the library is the laboratory, so this is the place where the people are. So you've got huge discrepancies in this respect. So in the digital world, basically you could say, well, most of sets, like we've seen, have become digital, and from the point of view of the library, in a way, it's business as usual. You've got acquisitions, like you had before, and you even merge acquisition departments for electronic and print. You do the same kind of cataloging, or you need the same kind of skills for making joint catalogs, as we've seen as well, or integrated catalogs, depending on how you see that. And you try to make things available to the others. But as we've seen, basically, the others do not care because they go through Google to find the data. Just a little story. I said, why are you? I came across a researcher who told me, why are you negotiating with those guys at Elsevier and to pay so much? Because when I look for a paper in an Elsevier journal, it's just free. It's on my desk. I said, there's a little correlation between the two. But there are quite a few researchers who do not even know that we spend hours negotiating deals between institutions and researchers. That's an issue. The point here is that for the library, there is very little insight in the content proper. The granularity is the document, the PDF. And most of the things are dealt with at the metadata level, which is a problem because this is the main discrepancy with the researchers who are looking for information within the documents. And this is where we need to find a way to reconcile the two. And the other main issue is that the academics, as we've heard also before, have become digital. So these guys is no more looking at, you know, things which are bubbling in a glass, but basically are looking for information. So looking at information online, creating primary data, like creating primary sources in the humanities, or actually in the astronomy, maybe you've heard about that. There is now 30% of the astronomers who have never seen a, what do you call that? Telescope. They are just compiling information from various sources, studying correlations across multi ranges of waves, and making observations like this. Many of them are doing, we've heard about that, online editions, but in a wide variety of ways. So compiling notes from an experiment, making laboratory books, all these things are now born digital and are new documents which are arriving online. And of course, I will not mention green open access. Too late, I've done. They're quite tempted. Well, I'll try to avoid that. I will not do it once more. They are tempted to put their own papers somewhere independently of publishers. You know, those guys at CERN, for instance, what they're doing. Research data is a major issue because the classical thing is the large Hadron colliders where you've got petabytes per second of data created. You need to manage that. And basically, scientists don't want to spend too much time on this. I mentioned the case of astrophysics. I could mention the important case of humanities at large, where all the work which was carried out in the library proper are now carried out from digital collections, which they somehow coordinate as researchers, but where you need some specific skills to deal with the workflow of digitizing, cataloging, distributing the corresponding collections. So that's a major issue for the research libraries. Our, they can be integrated in such a framework. And are we asking too much of them if we say, well, look, so far you've been putting books on shelves, and now we're asking you to deal with petabytes of data and be able to find the right information in there. There's a clash, maybe in competence or in duties, that we need to identify. One important aspect there is that the scientist, especially the, I've never made a difference between physician and physicist in English. Sorry, I'm not a native. I'm probably the only one there. So the one who are doing physics, you know, they think they know everything because they've understood the world, and they think also they can master technology, like with archive. It's not completely the case. You need to have some skills in information science to handle data, basically. So there is an opportunity there. And there are a lot of, I speak about open access, sorry, of opportunities also for the libraries to work together with the scientists to fulfill a few tasks. Digitization we've seen, managing born digital documents I've mentioned, and managing, like I said, research data or primary sources. And the point is that more and more people do ask, even with publication, to go beyond the metadata level. Typically for publication, so take the example of publication repository, you need to understand the actual content there to be able to create sub-collections for a specific research team, to be able to link papers with one another when you've got a bibliographical reference in a paper to actually link to the others. These are many things that the librarians would like to do themselves somehow. And this schema is not invented out of the blue in a way, because it's the result of discussions with the scientific information centers within INRIA. So a little bit of background information. INRIA is the national research organization in computer science in France and applied mathematics. And there are 8 centers, and each center has its own library. It's called now the Scientific Information Department. And basically, they are locally in charge of providing the editorial support for the publication archive of INRIA, which is HAL INRIA, which is the specific subset of the French National Archive HAL for this institution. And they actually intervene at many levels there. You see that at the author's deposit level, they need to deal with quality control, enhancement of metadata. They need to deal with legacy content as well, because the researcher would not want to put his publication himself, says, look, it's on my web page, do something with it. Or they've got to deal with the dissemination of information, providing nicely, automatically created web pages for the researchers, for the research teams, for the institution, providing, when the PR department of INRIA asks for that, the best of a certain researcher or a group of researchers in the given topic, and exploit, of course, bibliometry or reports. Every year, INRIA has to put together its annual report, and as we know, a publication archive can be quite a good tool for that. The thing which I put as a cloud, which is just starting, is all the related aspect to communication and training around the archive. This is something that the librarians are taking up step by step. And as we all know, even if we don't want to speak about open access and publication archives, this is already a routine in many institutions. I mean, it is deployed and many institutions are working there. And even if we've got such a routine, it does not work completely. It does not work in situations like the one I can mention there. You've heard about this agreement between the Max Planck Society and Springer, this kind of complex deal with some subscriptions and a full open access, gold open access scheme there, where part of the deal was that Springer would upload the corresponding publisher's PDF to the Max Planck publication archive. So politically, yeah, that was easy, not so much, but it was an agreement. But the difficulties, for those who read French, just a little, is actually to do the mapping from a technological point of view between the publisher's data and the actual publication repository data. And basically, I would not call this deal a success from a technological point of view, because it was very complex. And this is where the librarians at large had to fight within the Max Planck Society to actually make this deal a nice one for them or for us. Why is it so difficult? That's my little evangelization slide. It's because, yeah, it's a mess. It's a chaos. You guys, publishers, are providing a chaotic information if you don't know. You're all using proprietary formats, Scholar One-based formats, NLM 2.0.1.2.3, whatever, and you don't even know which version you're using. And when you're putting all this together, it makes a one-to-one mapping between one publisher and one institution very, very complex. Well, I could tell the institutions that each publication repository uses its own metadata profile, but I'm speaking to publishers there. So, but there are things where you're specifically bad and it's not your job. Typically, affiliations. It's the job of the institutions to control the affiliation they want to have from a point of view of visibility with regards to the Web of Science, for instance. There are things where you need to provide the right information, publication date, for instance. My experience is that there is quite some heterogeneity as to what you call the publication date of an article. It's probably obvious for your own. If it's not, ask me. I will show some funny examples. And you've got a lot of proprietary metadata fields. So typically, that comes from the peer project. I'm going to speak about it right afterwards. These are all the ways you express in your XML formats things like article title. And it's only taken out of 15 publishers. It's really a problem there. So sorting this out, I think the academic environment can play a role in this respect, at least to ensure better collaboration between publisher and academics in the way we want to make the scientific information environment evolve. It's important because we've got a vision within research institutions of some kind of patrimonial environment. We need to have a long-term management of our publications. Whatever the workflows, whatever the acquisitions we have on a short-term basis. And yes, it may not be seen as true, but it's not a fake message. We need some kind of interaction between publishers and research institutions to make the situation more transparent and to have a better understanding on what each of us could provide from the point of view of information. And the good experimental setting I would like to speak about quickly is the peer project. You've heard about this EU peer project because you're all partners in the project, even if you don't know. It's been a project initiated by the EU Commission. I would say the bigger partner and the coordinator is the smaller in the slide because it has only three letters. It's the STM Association. And the main idea initially was to study the impact of green of open access on the economy, behavior, a few similar topics of publishing at large, to see, for instance, whether putting a paper in a publication repository would unbalance the number of downloads between the publisher's website and the actual repository, but really mastering what we are doing there. The publishers came with a little bit, 241 journals, that's the current figure, if I'm not wrong, out of which we received all the metadata in a kind of centralized peer depot. I'll come back to this. And half of the papers are automatically deposited. It's called publisher's deposit. And half of the papers are put in a kind of basket whereby the authors are told that they are allowed to deposit the paper in their own archive or in a series of trusted archives. And all the metadata and the corresponding publisher's deposit PDFs are going into a peer depot and then forwarded to a series of publication repository that we've identified in the project. The main issue there is this one, is that putting together such an infrastructure forced us somehow to think about standardizing the representation, identifying what would be the kind of core metadata profiles that we could use within such a project to find the best compromise between the information chaos on the publisher's side, like I mentioned. You're not obliged to catch me after the talk, and the repository chaos as well on the other side. And the funny thing is that the librarians, at least within INRIA, have taken that as a real experimental setting for making their own skills evolve. So they were seminal in defining the workflows. They were seminal in defining the optimal target format that would ensure full interoperability between the various platforms. They were also at the core of this notion of quality control to make sure that we would be able to assess a certain level of quality for each of the field. What level of quality do we expect for the titles, for instance, of a paper? Very high, probably. What do we expect for the author's affiliation? Very high for the institution, not so high for the address, for instance. So there were some qualifiers there that we put together. And they took that very seriously because they saw that as the kind of pre-project for something which would go in the direction of what I mentioned, the full text archiving of the papers of their own institution. I would say independently of any idea of open access proper, it's really having the collection corresponding to the research institution there. And there, obviously, they put a strong emphasis on this notion of standardization strategy. If we want to have long-term preservation of content, we need to rely on a format which is not proprietary, which does not depend on a small company in the US who has defined the NLM 2.3 version B somewhere, but really on something which can be based on the large-scale initiatives such as the text encoding initiative. I will not enter into the details there, but there's been a kind of systematic view of digital content from the point of view of the library, saying, well, a journal paper is just one tiny object into a wide range of possible digital documents, books, laboratory books I mentioned, digital assets, primary sources in the humanities, for instance, and we need to have something like a coherent digitization background for all this. Conclusion. I'm set. The aim I've been somehow pursuing within the CNRS, within the Max Planck Society, and still within the INRIA at present is to, step by step, pushing a little bit with the thumbs, put the librarians as we know them now in a situation where they become real digital curators for a given research institutions, so that they are in the loop of the scientific information production workflow and they are actually collaborators, intimate collaborators, I would say, with the researchers. And this is what's going to, what is currently happening within INRIA, where scientists are actually going to the library not so much to take some information, but to ask for support for maintaining some digital information they have. And that's quite interesting in this respect. The point is that this proximity with the researchers implies that we need to be more demanding on the profiles when recruiting librarians. This change of skills may lead somehow to a higher level of recruitment within the libraries so that they are really considered at the right level by the professors, researchers in the institutions. The librarians I've interviewed within INRIA are actually taking very seriously this notion of new roles for the library and in investing in that. Taking the peer experiment, for instance, they understand that it can take a major, this technical infrastructure we've put together can take a major role in the negotiation of gold open access schemes, and not so much on green open access, contrary to what people would think about the peer project. So when you negotiate with a big publisher like Springer and being the Max Planck Society, you can use the peer depot, this one-stop shop, to automatically get all the metadata from your publisher and actually have the corresponding PDF, if you've paid for that. I mean, we all know it's a question of business between research environments and publishers. I think no one is naive there. This idea of long-term preservation is really a major point. This is the keywords that comes again and again within the institution in order not to lose the collection, not to throw away also the digital data like we've done with the printed data. Support for scientific data management is essential as well. And I mean, I think I've never seen even libraries with no technical means, any librarian being naive as to this evolution of scholarly communication and the importance of the academics themselves somehow to tune the process there. Thank you. Oh.